Precious us. Praise the King of Kings. I'm praise the Lord of Lords. I'm from the Rock Intercessor Ministries. I'm here today to preach to you. Hoping that some of you will give your heart to Jesus Christ today. Amen. Today's message is, are you saved? Are you saved, my dear friend? May I ask you that question? Are you saved? You see, there's nothing anything else in this world that is more wonderful knowing that you are saved and be certain that you are sure that you have been saved. You see, Jesus came not as a philosopher, not as an educator, not as an economist, not as a banker, not as a politician, not as a social worker, but Jesus Christ came to save. Why? Because salvation is man's greatest need. Salvation is man's greatest need. Not your philosophy, not your education, not your economy, not your finance, not your politics, not your health. But man's greatest need is salvation. And you knowing certainly that you have been saved, that you cannot lose it, my dear friend, it is very, very important that you understand the message. Amen. If you listen to the word of Jesus Christ, Luke chapter 19, verse 10, Jesus said, "For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." That is why Jesus Christ stepped out of heaven and he came to this earth. Now I want you to know that when you give your heart to Jesus Christ, you are entirely secure. Listen to this scripture. God's words in the book of John, excuse me, verse 10, book of John chapter 10, verse 27. Jesus said, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me." Now listen to this. "I give them eternal life, and they will never ever perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all. No one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand." Now, my dear friends, I am not talking about something that is incidental. I am talking about something that is fundamental. I'm talking about something that is internally security for a believer. That you can know that you're internally secure. It is necessary for your spiritual health. I mean, can you imagine what emotional state of mind any child could be if that child day by day does not know whether or not he or she were a member of a family, or maybe I was a good boy, a member of the family, then the next day I was not so good, I'm no longer a member of the family. I am loved by my father, or I'm not loved by my father. I'm receiving the family, I'm not receiving the family. Friends, that would be like a person roller coaster in their life. You see, because why? They don't have emotional stability. And yes, but if you come to Jesus Christ, the Bible says those who have received him, that's what John tells us in the book of John, 1 John chapter 1, he has given right to be called the sons and daughters of God. Sons not by the blood and flesh, but by the power of the Holy Spirit, my dear friend. So this is good for your emotional strength. This is good also for your spiritual life. You see, because why? If you have emotional stability, if you are a child of God, you ought to know, and you ought to know that you are a child of God. And that enables you to do what? To be active, to be spiritual productive, and for you to know that you are a child of God. And I want you to know this, because why? If you know that your future is being secure as a Christian, you will be productive, you will bear fruit. This helping me in my evangelism, that I know that God is good, that I've been saved. And that is why today I can look inside your face, I can look at your faces, and I tell you today that I accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and personal Savior. The problem I have here today, number of many people who never get saved, and frankly speaking, they're afraid. They think they cannot hold out. They think they're not able, or they don't have the strength, or the wisdom and the knowledge, and they don't have the will or the power. And because of this, they make a false start, and then they fall away. Many people are like that. Many people today are afraid because they have a false start, and then they fall away. You have to listen to what the Bible says about this. And I want you to know, my dear friend, that God is He who saves you. God who secures you. God is who keeps you. The same God who saved me, have secured me, have kept me. And I want to let you know today that if you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and personal Savior, you have internal assurance as a believer to know. You see, and it is good, it is necessary for us to do what? To know this. Knowing this, I want you also to know, joining a church, getting baptized, giving money, all these spiritual things. But if you haven't received Jesus Christ as your Lord and personal Savior, if you haven't taken part in the divine nature, which is the twice born, who received the first, who received the new birth, the person you are never going to get saved until you receive that new birth. When you receive that new birth, you cannot be lost. If you have been born again, you cannot be lost, because God says really that He knows those who are His and those who are not. Listen to the word of God in the book of Matthew chapter 7, verse 22. Jesus Christ said, on that last day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, didn't you prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do mighty works in your name? Now, verse 23, then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I listen, my dear friend. He didn't say, I once knew them and you lost. You lost it. No. He said, I never knew you. So you may prophesy. You thought. You may cast out demons. You may do mighty wonders, mighty works. You thought. But He said, I never knew you. So, to prophesy and to cast out demons, you thought you are doing this. But Jesus Christ said on that last day, I never knew you. Do you know why? Because you have not been saved. You see, you are not to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and personal Savior. Remember the scripture I just read to you? John 10, verse 27. Jesus said, I know my sheep. Listen, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. You say, Brother Kingsley, what happens when somebody joins a church and they get baptized, and for a while they go? Are you telling me they were never saved? Yes, that's what I'm saying. They never saved, because when you go away and you stay away, that means you never be saved. John tells us this in 1 John chapter 2, verse 19. John explains about those who start for a while and then they follow. This is what John says. Now listen to it carefully. 1 John chapter 2, verse 19. They went out from us, but they are not of us. For if they had been of us, they could have continued with us. But they went out that they might be plain. They are not of us. So that's what John says here in 1 John chapter 2, verse 19. They went out from us because they were not of us. John said, if they had been of us, they could have continued with us. And that's the reason many people today, they fell away. And frankly speaking, you fell away because why? You never been saved from the beginning. From the get-go, you never had the salvation. There's no way that you have the salvation, you lose it. Judas never lost his salvation. Judas was never saved. The Bible said that Jesus Christ knew from the beginning that Judas did not believe in him. So we are talking about internal security here, my dear friend. I'm talking to you today about your internal security. And I'm telling you here today that if you have a personal, vital relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, you, my dear friend, can never lose your salvation. And now I'm going to give you 8 reasons why you are internally secure. And each of these begin with the letter P. Why? So that you cannot forget it. Now the first letter P, the first word is promise. For God has promised you internal security in Romans chapter 8 verse 38. Now this is what Apostle Paul going to tell us, that about this, I'm absolutely certain of this. Paul have a deep conviction of this. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor present nor the things to come, nor powers, nor height nor depth. And in case if you left anything out, he said, not anything else in all creation will be able to separate you from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. So you see, Paul had given us 10 mighty lists of opponents that can never separate us from the love of God. He said, death cannot do it. If you die, you are staying in the love of God. Life cannot do it. If you live, you are staying in the love of God. Angel cannot do it. Good angels and bad angels. Remember, Satan is an angel, but a fallen angel. So that means angels can't do it. Life can't do it. Death can't do it. Then he said authorities. They can't do it. He said the thing that is present, meaning the thing that is happening right now in this world. He said I can't do it either. He said the things to come, everything that has ever been created, can never do what do it. He said height means the thing that is in heaven above. He said death means the thing that is beneath below. And finally he said, just in case if you didn't cover the basis, he says, he continues saying, and not anything else or any creation else. So that means Apostle Paul have covered everything. He said nothing can separate us from the love of God that which is in Christ Jesus. Amen. And that's the promise of it, my dear friend. That's the promise of it. Nothing can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus Christ. Now this brings me to the second reason. Not only the promise, but the perseverance. He said the perseverance. Now for God, he will complete that he'll begin you. The Bible says in the book of Philippians chapter 1 verse 6. Yes, a wonderful verse. Again, Paul says, I'm sure of this, that he will begin a good work in you. We bring it to completion at the day of Christ, at the day of Jesus Christ. And that's when Jesus Christ comes again. And by the way, my dear friend, Jesus Christ is coming soon. And when we got saved, who began the good work in you? Was it you or God? It was God. Why do we love him? Because he first loved us. He began a good work in us. And he's the one who called us through the power of the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit is super agent of the new birth. Holy Spirit, first of all, convict you of your sin. That's what the Bible says in the book of John. He's the one who showed you that you are a sinner. You needed to be saved. And not only that, he was the converter. And he was also the converter. So he's the one who opened your eyes. And he's the one who helped you to understand the gospel. And he's the one who put faith in your heart. And he's the one who helped you to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and personal Savior. The Holy Spirit, he's the converter. And listen, my dear friends, as well. Also, he is the one, the completer. He will begin a good work in you. The converter, the convert, we perform it. We complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. Okay, have you ever started anything that you're not able to finish? I started some things, many things I was not able to finish. But Jesus Christ has never started anything that is not able to finish. God the Father never started anything that is not able to finish. Holy Spirit never started anything that is not able to finish. I am so glad that God will complete the good work which he has started with us. Let me tell you, my dear friend, if you give out to Jesus Christ, you will be completed. That job will be completed. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit will complete that job that which he started in you. There's nothing too big for God to do, my dear friend. Apostle Paul said, I am confident of this one thing. I'm confident of this thing, that he will begin a good work in you. We perform it. So you see, any child of God, any God's elect, will never be perished. Amen? Will never perish. God the Father cannot be defeated in his promises. God the Son cannot be disappointed with his blood. God the Holy Spirit cannot be disgraced by the power to keep you. The Bible says he will begin a good work in you. We bring it to accomplishment, my dear friend. To complete it, he will begin a good work. So, the first promise, the first word is promise, the second is perseverance, and now the third one is what? Predestination. Predestination. The book of Romans chapter 8 verse 28, the Bible says, for those who he foreknew, speaking of God here, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son. In order that they might become the firstborn among many brothers. No, verse 13. And those who he predestined, he also called. And those who he called, he also justified. And those who he justified, he also glorified. And the Bible said that God foreknew certain ones. And when God foreknew certain ones, God predestined certain ones. For whom he foreknew, he then predestinated. And I'm telling you today, I mean, what is predestination? It means that your destiny is already predestinated. God has predestined your destiny. You see, you have to be sure of this, my dear friend. There's nothing else to be sure than predestined. You are predestined to be in heaven. Then you will be in heaven. If you do not get to heaven, you were never predestined to be in heaven. God says that you are predestined to be like the Lord Jesus Christ. You will not be in hell. And to be like Lord Jesus Christ, all this verse giving you the clear view that you ought to understand this, my dear friend. God giving us these verses, and I want to give you these five golden links. Number one is for knowledge. Number two, predestination. Number three is calling. Number four is justification. Number five is glorification. If you are a child of God, God already see you glorified. He already see you in heaven. He does not say he will glorify. He says that you are already glorified. That's what the Bible says. That's what the Bible says here in the book of Romans chapter 8 verse 30. So you see, your salvation did not begin with you. Your salvation began before this world was created. God saw you before ever this world was created. God saw you glorified. God saw you in heaven. God knows the past, the present, the future, all the time at one time. God is the essence of this, my dear friend. And I want you to know this, my dear friend. You see, because God sees you now predestined for heaven. God sees you already in heaven. God sees you predestined like our Lord Jesus Christ. And God already sees you glorified. Tell me what else can stop this. Tell me what else can hinder this. You can never lose your salvation if you're already predestined to be like Jesus Christ. God saw me way back when I gave my heart to Jesus Christ, that I will be like Jesus Christ. It is predestined. It is settled. It is absolutely well settled, my dear friend. There's nothing else more to be sure than predestined. So friends, what is settled in eternity cannot be undone by time. What has been declared by heaven cannot be unmoved by hell. Romans chapter 11 verse 29, the Bible says, the gift and the calling of God are irrevocable. What does this mean? It means that God does not change his mind. God never changed his mind. The gift and the calling of God are without repentance. God foreknew. God called. God knows. God predestined that I will be like Lord Jesus Christ. Let me tell you, my dear friend, you are looking at somebody who's going to be like Jesus Christ one day. And if you give your heart to Jesus Christ, you will be the same thing, my dear friend. Now, this brings me to the fourth P. Not only about predestination, but now perfection. Perfection. The book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 10, I love this verse so much. What a wonderful verse. Hebrews chapter 10 verse 14. For by one single offering, he has perfected all time those who have been sanctified. Those who have been sanctified. By one offering, he, that Jesus Christ, has perfected forever those who have been sanctified. So what is the one offering that the Bible is saying here? He's talking about his precious blood being poured out on the cross of Calvary. That one offering make a perfect forever. For how long? Forever. Now listen to this, my dear friend, about your salvation. I want you to listen to this. When you got saved, God does not pay down payment as we know here today, like monthly installment. No. Many of you today have that idea. No. That's a misguided view. This is not about start and stop. This is not about start and flesh. You, my dear friend, the Bible said that God had made the payment once and for all. Jesus Christ get the job done, my dear friend. He paid it in full. Amen. He perfected it forever. That you have been satisfied, it is done. I have been made perfect forever in the sight of God. So, friends, when you got a new nation, it is by his offering that he perfected for it forever, for one time. And listen, my dear friend, in our flesh, we are not perfect. When we disobey God, the Bible says, discipline us. For whom the Lord love, he shall chasten. Here's the scripture. Talks about perfection. Romans chapter 4, verse 5. And to the one who does not work, but believes in him, who justifies the ungodly, faith is counted as righteousness. Faith is counted as righteousness. You are not saved by doing good works, but you are saved not based on your good works. You are saved by you believing in him. You are justified. God justified the ungodly by faith, and is counted to them as righteousness. Just as David also speak about the blessing of the one who God count righteousness apart from works. And that's so wonderful, because God put righteousness on your account, not with works, my dear friend. Blessed are those whose lawlessness things are forgiven, and whose sins are covered. So not only that God forgive your sin, God also covers your sin, my dear friend. God covers our sin. When we confess our sin, God do what? Covers our sin. Blessed is the man whom the Lord does not count his sin. Hallelujah. Glory be to God, my dear friend. Blessed is the man who God imputes righteousness. Blessed is the man, the sins have been forgiven. Blessed is who sins are covered. Blessed is the man who God will not impute sin. So you see, one sin can send you to hell forever. One sin can send me to hell forever. But blessed is the man to whom God does not impute sin. Why? Because by one offering, he has perfected it forever. And then that satisfies. So now, after perfection, this brings me to the next P. The next P is position. Position. You are in position in Christ. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old things have begun. The new have begun. The new have come. So, in the old nation, that is Adam and his children. In the new nation, in the new creation, that is Jesus Christ and his children. So everybody that is in Adam, they are still having the old nation. Everyone that is in Christ Jesus Christ, they are having the new nation. You see, if anyone is in Christ, it's a new creation. A new creation means I am in our Lord Jesus Christ. What pertains to Jesus Christ pertains to me. I'm not going to lose my relationship. Just in the same way, God, Jesus Christ can never lose the relationship with God the Father. So, because I'm in Christ Jesus, Jesus Christ is in me. So what is true of Jesus Christ is also true to me. Because I am in Christ Jesus, I am not Christ, but I am in Christ Jesus Christ. Apostle Paul tells this in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 23. You are Christ, and Christ is God. Amen? Peter also tells us that the Noah's Ark is a picture of our salvation. Noah's Ark is a picture of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is more than just the story about the great ship. Do you remember how Noah was saved? God said to Noah, I'm going to destroy the whole world with a flood, but I want you and your family not to perish. So God brought Noah and his family into the ark. If any man is in Christ, God brings you inside the ark. Genesis chapter 7 verse 1, the Bible says that God said to Noah, come inside the ark, and you and your household. Now, when God said to Noah, come inside, that means God was inside the ark. Now, if I'm in a room, and I say, come inside, that means I'm inside the room. If I'm not inside the room, if I'm outside, I say go there, that means I ask you to go there because I'm not there. The Bible says this in Genesis chapter 7 verse 1. Come inside the ark. That means God was inside the ark and Noah come inside the ark where God was. The Bible says, then God shuts the ark. Now why did God have to shut the door? He shut the door so there will be no water. And then he shut Noah's in. He shut the water out and then shut Noah's in. It was God who shut the door. Now the Bible tells us this in Ephesians chapter 1 verse 13. In him you also, when you hear the word of the truth and the gospel of your salvation and you believe in him, we are sealed with the promise of the Holy Spirit, who is a guarantee for our inheritance until we acquire the possession of it to the praise of his glory. So you, my dear friend, you have to receive Jesus Christ. You have to receive the Holy Spirit. You have to be born again. Jesus Christ saying himself, you must be born again before you can see the kingdom of God. If you receive the Holy Spirit, you have been sealed. You have been sealed. So the only way Noah could go down is the ark go down. And the only way he could lose his salvation if Jesus Christ go down. But my dear friend, I am in Christ Jesus Christ. I am in the Lord Jesus Christ. If any man is in Christ, the Bible says he is a new creation. So Noah may have fallen many times in the ark, but he never fall out of the ark. And that is very important that we understand this. Sure, a Christian can slip, stumble and fall. But God shut Noah in. God shut the door after he had believed. So you are sealed with the Holy Spirit of God, my dear friends. It is important that you get to know. Because this is very important, because now you know that you have been saved. And my message for you today is what? Are you saved, my dear friend? Are you saved? Because if you are not saved, why not? You can be saved today. If you are willing to give your heart to Jesus Christ. You see, because why? If you know that you have been saved, you have to know where your security is. You see, because your security is not in a place. Remember that the fallen angels, they were not kept there. They were cast out from the heavens. The same way today, I want you to know you need to put your position in the right place. And that name is Jesus Christ. In the name of Jesus Christ, the Bible says, if any man is in Christ Jesus Christ, he's a new creature. That's where your position should be, in our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, this brings me to the second, to the next P. Now, the next P is possession. Possession. Possession, you already have eternal life. Listen to the scripture, John 5 verse 24. Jesus said, truly, truly, I say to you, whoever hears my word and believes in him who sent me has eternal life. Has eternal life, my dear friend. It does not come into judgment, but I have passed from death to life. Nothing will get to you, my dear friend. You have to know that you have eternal life. That's what the Bible says. You has eternal life. Means you already have it. Not after, you have it right now. If you are willing to give your heart to Jesus Christ. Listen to the verse again. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever hears my word and believes in him who sent me has eternal life. So that means you have it right now. You're internally secure. Jesus Christ said, he who has the Son have life. But he who do not have the Son does not have any life. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever hears my voice and believes in him who sent me, listen to this, has eternal life. So the eternal life, my dear friend, belongs to Jesus Christ, and he gives it to you. Amen? Now, this brings me to the seventh reason. And the seventh reason is prayer. Prayer. Jesus Christ interceding for us. Jesus Christ praying for us in the book of John, chapter 17, verse 9. I'm praying for them. I'm not praying for the world. Listen to that. I'm praying for them. I am not praying for the world, but for those whom you have given to me, for they are yours. So why was he praying for them? In verse 15, I do not ask that you take them out of the world, but you keep them from the evil one. That's very important. You keep them from the evil one. Just why he's praying for us. Not that you escape the trials and tribulations or the headache and difficulty. The Bible says through trials and tribulations, we can make it into the kingdom of God. But he's praying for us to save us from the evil one. So, just Christ said, I'm praying for them. Don't tell them out of the world, but Father, I pray for them that you keep them from the evil one. Hallelujah. So God is praying for us today, my dear friend. I want you to understand it, that God is interceding for us. Don't get the idea that Jesus Christ rose again from death, is in heaven, sitting on the throne, sitting down. He's still making intercession for us, my dear friend. He's still interceding for us, you see. And he's praying for us so that we'll not be harmed with evil one. So then in verse 20, I did not ask for this only, now watch this, but also for those who will believe in me through that word. My name is here and your name is there if you give your heart to Jesus Christ. My name is there. When Jesus Christ pray for those who are going to come later, I'm part of it. You will be part of it today, my dear friend, if you are willing to give your heart to Jesus Christ. Amen. Now Hebrews chapter 7 verse 25. Consequently, he's able to save the utmost, those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. He always lives to make intercession for them. Jesus Christ always lives to do what? To make intercession for us, my dear friend. So his prayer, that's the reason I am secure. That's the reason I've been saved. That's the reason I've been kept. That's the reason I will make it to heaven, because of the prayer of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Now this brings me now to the last P, and the last P is power. Power. Listen to these powerful verses. 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 3. Blessed be the God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living, God bless you, to a living hope, and to the resurrection of Jesus Christ from death, to inheritance that is imperishable, undefined, unfading, kept in heaven for you. Kept in heaven where? In for heaven for you. Now watch this. By whom? By God's power. By God's power, being guided through faith for a salvation already to be revealed in the last time. Who are kept by the power of God? I'm telling you today, think about it, my dear friend. I've been kept by the power of God. There's no devil in hell, out of hell, can move me if I've been kept by the power of God. I want you to understand this, my dear friend. Because devil is powerless. In fact, devil is useless. He can't do anything. Remember what Jesus Christ said in John chapter 10, verse 27? Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. That's a power. That's a power when God saved you, my dear friend. My message for you today, are you saved? Because if you are not saved, why not? You can be saved today, my dear friend. You see? So there's a power, there's no power strong enough to pray us open the hands of Almighty God. Just Christ said, my Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all. No one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. So you see that God has power. God has power. Remember what Jesus Christ said to Peter? God bless you.
How are you?
Sorry?
How are you?
I'm blessed, sir.
It needs to be a bit louder.
Sorry?
I'm not giving you a kiss, but it needs to be.
God bless you. God bless you, brother. God bless you. God bless you. Amen. So you, my dear friend, I want you to understand this. Jesus Christ said to Peter, Satan has desired you, but I pray for you. Hallelujah. Devil desired Peter. Peter denied Jesus Christ 3 times, but guess what? We pray for him. Jesus Christ prayed for Peter, and Peter was saved. And I'm telling you today that God is praying for us through the power of his prayer. That's why we have been saved. That's why I have been saved. Not based on you, not based on anything else, based on what Jesus Christ did, based on his prayer, based on intercession, based on his grace, based on his mercy, based on his love, based on his grace, based on his predestination, based on his promise, based on the position where we position ourselves in him. Only Jesus Christ can keep you saved. Only Jesus Christ can save you. Jesus Christ said in the book of John, chapter 10, verse 28, I give you eternal life. I didn't say, I give you eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. My dear friend, it is well and clear. Are you saved? That's today's message. Are you saved? If you are not saved, you can be saved today. Come today accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and personal Savior. So you, my dear friend, can be sure about your internal assurance, internal security, based on the Jesus Christ, based on what you've done on our cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. Remain blessed in the mighty name of Jesus. Jesus Christ is Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen and amen. Jesus is Lord.